We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
I got this feeling inside my bones. It goes electric, wavy when I turn it on.
Hi, everybody. It's Del and Debbie's Mind, Body, and Soul. Welcome to LA Talk Live. We are here today to give you some information on how to live your best life. I am Debbie Carlin Boyle. I am one of your co-hosts. I am a personal trainer, fitness instructor, and a life and a health coach for nutrition. And my co-host right here beside me is the beautiful...
Hi, thank you. I'm Del A.D. Jones, and I'm a certified transformational life coach. And I specialize in the areas of personal growth, relationships, and divorce recovery. And we have a very exciting show today. We have the subject of our show today is how to live a healthy and happy life at any age. And to help inspire us on our journey to living our best life possible, we'd like to welcome a very, very special guest, author and healthy living architect, Christy Miller. And we are so, yes, we're Bravo. So excited yes. because she is a powerhouse in the world of physical fitness and health. And she's going to be here today and she's going to share her skills and tools and everything that she utilizes when she's supporting her clients in just having that healthy, beautiful lifestyle that she has achieved for herself. So welcome, Christy. Thank you so much for joining us. I know how busy you are. So.
Yes. Thank you for having me. It's such a pleasure to be here with two lovely ladies that are Thank also you. Focused on health and wellness.
Thank you.
Wonderful. Well, yeah, we are just thrilled to hear about everything that you're involved in because it just warms my heart to have somebody that's right in my wheelhouse doing all of this stuff and being very successful at it and helping others on a really huge level.
Yeah, I just want to mention, I just met Christy a couple of weeks ago, and it was through this this summit that you put together, which was incredible. And we're going to get to that a little bit later. But before that, you have a really, really fascinating journey of what got you to this place. So we'd like to hear a bit about your background. I know you grew up in Southern California. So just start there and then take us through this really interesting journey okay. of different professions.
Yes, it is. It really, and something people can relate to. And,
yeah.
And yeah, change. I will give you the short version.
Okay, exactly.
I suffer from what is termed career ADD, which means I change careers quite often, but I have finally found what I want to be when I grow up. So healthy living architect, this is the final hurrah. This is going to be it.
Yay.
We'll remind you of that when you come out with something fabulous in a couple of years.
Yeah, unless it's retirement, hit me upside the head.
Okay.
So I graduated from USC way back when, I don't even know, 87, I think mm-hmm. it was, and became a financial analyst. That was all planned. Then decided after 5 years to go back to either law school or get my MBA. I let the entrance exams dictate which way I was going to go mm-hmm. and ended up going to law school, became a corporate attorney, working my butt off, 80 hours a week, wow. flying all over the country, doing deals, wheeling and dealing, and I loved it. And in 2010, I was the lead attorney flying on private jets closing an $8.6 billion with a B.
Oh, my goodness.
Billion-dollar deal. And the day before it was scheduled to close, my dad died.
Oh, I'm so sorry to hear that.
Yeah, and this was a really big wake-up call for me because I was my father's daughter. He worked too much. I worked too much. He ate crap. Can I say crap on the radio?
yes.
I ate crap. He smoked too much. I drank too much. Mm-hmm. I was on that same path, and I realized in that moment at the echelon of my career, doing exactly what I loved, that I had to make a choice. And it was, I can get off this train at the next stop, or I'm gonna ride it until it crashes and there will be no survivors.
Wow.
And so I made the very hard decision to just walk away from a very lucrative career that I actually loved because I had to save myself.
Yeah. Now, well, was your that takes a lot yes. to be able to do that.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Now, was your father's passing, was that a shock? Was that something you saw coming? How did that transpire?
I think it's always a shock. We saw it coming. He was, his doctor actually called him a train wreck. Thus my analogy for poor dear old dad who I loved so much. He died from preventative diseases. Diabetes. He had had a triple bypass years before that because he was a smoker most of his life. You know, he just, he was a CPA. He had his favorite pencil, his favorite eraser, and his favorite candy jar.
And how old was he when he passed?
He was just a week short of his 73rd birthday.
Okay. And young.
Yeah. And about 10 years before that, I had lost my mom to cancer.
Ooh. Oh. Yeah.
So at age 36, here I was, an adult orphan. And 2 weeks before my dad died, he looked at me and said, "I did this to myself."
Wow. So he knew.
He knew. Yeah. We just saw the end coming. Had I really seen that it was going to happen that day, I wouldn't have been in the office closing the deal.
Yeah.
In fact, we were on the middle of a conference call with about 20 different attorneys and bankers and everyone to get this deal closed. And in the middle of the call, I just had a gut feeling. And I said, "We're not getting anywhere. Everyone hang up. Call back into the line in 30 minutes. And my paralegal, Mandy, looked at me like, "What are you, crazy? What, do you have to go to the bathroom? Like, what's going on?" And I just said, "I have to call my dad." And I called, and his nurse said he's no longer speaking.
Wow.
And I went into the CEO's office and said, "My dad's dying. I got to go." And his response was, "What about the deal?"
Wow.
Wow.
Well, that was, the universe telling you that you didn't belong there anymore.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
The timing was,
well, and
sort
just the
of
lack
a universal
of sensitivity to your personal situation. That's pretty outrageous.
Yeah, you can imagine what my response was.
Yeah.
It was sign language.
Oh, really?
No, I'm sure.
Yes.
Sure.
Oh, my goodness. Aww. Now, it's those wake-up calls, isn't it? And I look at, I was sharing earlier that my mother is facing, you know, illnesses that are due to diabetes as well, that you wouldn't think, undiagnosed diabetes. So it's been a bit of a wake-up call in my family too. My other sister's battling a cancer as well. So we're all sitting there and reevaluating how we're living our lives and what we're eating and what we're putting into it. And I've always loved exercise, but definitely paying attention more to what I'm putting in my body.
Yeah, and the good news is it's never too late.
No, it's
never
too
late.
It's
exactly.
It's, you know, our parents taught us a lot, and our grandparents taught us a lot. And for a long time, I think that everyone, you know, when we were little kids, and I know for me, when I was a little girl, when I saw elderly people, I immediately thought of illness. And I thought they went hand in hand, and that was just a given. And it doesn't have to be that way. And that is something I learned as an adult and growing up. And wow, you really do have control. It's not genetics, it's lifestyle and food. Number one thing, what you put in your body. All diseases, 95% of them start in the gut. All of them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I lost my father when I was 20. He was 46. Same
That's
thing,
so
train wreck,
too.
Same lifestyle as your dad. He just didn't make it as long. And that was a wake-up call for me. And, you know, not everybody, people see that, but not everybody realizes that because they just think, well, things are going to hurt. You're going to get it sick. Everybody gets sick when they get old, and then they get kind of put away for a while until they pass. No, it does not have to be that way. And I love messengers that discover that and want to get the message out.
Yeah, and there's so many messages out there that we can keep learning from. And even when we get to a certain point, we can elevate it to another level. My husband was diagnosed with cancer last year. Mm. He had surgery 30 days before losing his identical twin to cancer. I didn't like 2016 very much.
Yes.
And we have both elevated our health to the next level. My husband is now cancer-free. But, you know, we were already doing really well. We had both lost weight, over 60 pounds combined, and we had been maintaining for years, but sugar was slipping back in. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, it's out now. It's an occasional fun food as opposed to a daily consumption.
Yeah. Right, yeah. Well, no good properties in sugar, but it's everywhere. Everything turns into sugar pretty much that is processed. So it's everywhere. But that's, you know, an individual education, and there's general things that, you know, people can do, but it's not good.
So I want to go back for a second to that day when they were not very sensitive. Am I moving you around,
yes,
Debbie?
You are.
Sorry.
Every time you move, I move with you.
Okay.
We're on a little train.
At the hip,
yeah.
So that day when you left, did you go back to work? How did you transition into what you do now?
Yeah.
Well, actually, before I even say that, because I think there was a few other things in between that are really interesting that I want to hit upon.
They actually came after.
Oh, they did?
They came out. There were some pit stops. So my dad died the next day and I took some time off, and then I went back in, I don't know, a week later or so, and I decided that I just had to get out of there. Mm-hmm. And no, I think we took it's kind of fuzzy in my head now because it's been so long. It's been 17 years. I think my husband and I went on a great vacation and just splurged on this killer vacation. And then I went back to work. And within a month, I'm like, no, I can't do it. And I remember giving my notice and the CEO saying, you're just in pain. Take the weekend off. And I took the weekend off, and I came back, and I was like skipping down the hallway because I had had 48 hours off. And then within 3 days, I was miserable again. And so then I just transitioned out and decided to just focus on my health and happiness. I played a lot of golf. I drank a lot of beer. I ate a lot of hot dogs. You're seeing I was only focusing on one thing.
I was just saying. So is that focusing on your health?
No, it was
golf, maybe.
Apparently my mental health. Yeah, I mean, I was just out there.
Yeah, you needed to release and have some fun and do the polar opposite of what that intense stress was.
Exactly.
Probably.
So I ended up gaining more weight.
Yeah, of course.
You know, and this kind of went on for years. At one point, I got a little bored. I was watching TV and looked at my husband and said, that looks like fun. I'm going to do that. And what I was watching was a reality show that was filmed at the LA County Sheriff's Academy. Uh-huh. And next thing you know, at age 44, I am full-fledged recruit with LA County. Like, we're not going to go somewhere safe and play with this. Like, we're going to go right into LA County.
Oh, my God.
What were you watching? Like, Cops or something?
No, it was called The Academy.
Oh,
and I think it ran for like 2 seasons or 3 seasons, and it really did follow the recruits through the Sheriff's Academy. And the episode that I had caught was all about the physical training, jumping over the walls, climbing the fences, you know.
You liked the challenge of that. That looked really intriguing to you.
Yeah.
That's so funny. So what did your husband say when you went?
He gave me the stress
in that job at all.
Yeah, he gave me the typical response that he always does when I lift my hand and say, I have an idea or I've been thinking. And it was just, oh, here we go again.
Oh, sounds exciting.
Like he's used to it.
But he got to sleep with the sheriff.
So how did that? So there you go. You went into and you became a sheriff. So that had to be pretty intense for you and a really big shift.
It was the hardest thing that I think I've ever done in my life. And I told my husband it was harder than the first year of law school.
Wow.
Not in terms of the intellectual challenge, although I went into it saying, I'm going to be the top academic recruit. I'm going to be the top female recruit. Like, if I do this, I am doing it. And I never had those goals in law school to be like number one or any of that. But I don't know what it was. It was this feeling of a midlife badassery, not to be confused with a midlife crisis. Two totally different things. Yeah. I didn't get the Porsche. I kept the husband. I kept the house. I just went out and got a gun and a badge instead.
Say that could be a midlife crisis, and just in terms of changing gears and mixing it up, you know.
Oh, I think that sounds fabulous.
Yeah.
So how long did that last for?
Just under a year. Oh. I never intended to be a sheriff long term.
It was just a goal.
Like, I really just wanted to go. I have great respect for law enforcement, so this is going to sound a little bit weird, but I just wanted to go try it out.
Yeah.
And really learn the criminal mind and really learn what it takes to be on the streets or in the jails or whatever. And it was absolutely fascinating and so intriguing on a daily basis.
Wow. Really? I'm sure there was a fear factor involved too. Like, was that like an adrenaline thing
that
would keep you daily, alert at least?
Yeah. The very first day on my shift, you start out in the jails. In my very first shift, I was taken into this jail module, and I had 128 inmates. They all have to be let out of their cells to eat. I have no gun. I have no baton. Like, you don't carry those because they can be used on you. And I have no training officer. I am there alone with the inmates.
Is this a female prison or a male?
This was female prison.
Female, yeah.
And I have to let them out of their cells for dinner.
Okay, so
and
that's
it's
your
just
job.
Me, and what you call your command presence. But I had no idea what I was doing. Nobody trained me. And my training officer wasn't there that day.
Now, were you afraid at all?
Yes.
Only because I'm thinking, I mean, we can smell fear. And that's not a place you want to be reeking of fear.
No. I was very thankful at that point to be older than the other new deputies, because most new deputies are in their early 20s. So I had that. And I was very thankful to have lawyer poker face.
Yes.
So I knew about that.
Yeah, yeah, several of the inmates told me that I scared the crap out of them.
Wow.
And I'm like, great, because I need to wash my uniform. it was so scary. In fact, we have our own private bathroom that has a little peephole. I had to go to the bathroom so bad, I didn't go. Because when I open that door, how do I know if there aren't inmates behind the door that are going to jump me?
Yeah.
Oh, so
there's no protection.
That's wow.
Right. Yeah.
And that's interesting that they didn't train you for that they just threw you into the fire, so to speak.
Yeah, they like to play little games like that.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's what part of it was really interesting, getting to see the inmates' mind, but also getting to see inside the deputies' minds and, you know, certain parts of jealousy or intimidation or whatever that's playing in the way that they act toward their fellow deputies.
Interesting.
So did that continue to happen the whole time that you were?
Oh yeah, I got called in for insubordination for refusing to lie on a report, and so I think, I don't remember exactly, but I think it was the lieutenant, the sergeant, the captain, and the very first question during this meeting, and I really didn't care because I wasn't going to be a long-term sheriff, so I'm like, yeah, insubordination, whatever. And the very first question out of this gal's mouth, the sergeant, was, so I'm reading your biography and I see that both of your parents are dead. That must be really hard.
Oh geez.
And then I was like, oh babe, you ain't gonna crack me, like, game on.
Well. Yeah.
Now, I have a quick question here, because I know, we'll get back to the health and fitness for a second. We can get really sidetracked on this one. So you mentioned that you lost, was it like 30 pounds, somewhere around 30 pounds.
Now, 31. We count 31. Every single pound at each train win.
Okay. So 31 pounds. Now, was that prior to becoming a sheriff or after?
It was after.
I'm thinking of all the training you have to do.
It was after. In fact, I was looking through a lot of the photos to bring you guys a sheriff photo. Uh-huh. And there were so many photos where I could see my uniform, the pants, just like really pulling and tugging. I might have been the only recruit that actually gained a little bit of weight in the academy.
Stress eating.
My husband was giving me a Rupert float every night.
Whoa.
Every night.
Yeah.
I'd come home
he thought that would help you unwind.
It was his
funny
language
how
of love.
We use those things has rewards and
big ol' emotional eating going on for sure.
So what transition? What? So you went into it, like you just said, knowing that you weren't going to last, and so you just did it for fun or to try it out, and you knew you were going to take a different turn.
Yeah. I mean, this was quite honestly a short term investment.
And you knew that from the get go, right when you went in to do all the recruiting.
Yeah. I was pretty much thinking I'm going to go to the academy, graduate, and then quit.
Oh, okay. Just to see if you could make it.
The midlife badassery.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then I was like, you know what? This is really interesting. I'm going to go be a sheriff for a while. Mm-hmm. And then it just, through a turn of events and me seeing things inside the department that really scared me, not from a fear of the inmates, but the bureaucracy, the corruption, not having your back. I was like, babe, I'm out of here.
Yeah. So that's when you went into interior design. Or was that before?
Yeah.
You just segued out, or you say, I quit, and then you had downtime, and then the interior design, or?
The interior design was a little bit before that and after that, it's still going. I'm actually just got hired now to design a healthy kitchen and gym and master suite for a client that I had worked for 5-10 years ago.
Yeah.
So I'm doing a little bit of that again, but it's within
combined
the Eat, Train, Win community, which is
love
really
it.
Fun.
So you can incorporate all that together.
Yeah. So I quit the sheriff's department, and then it was about a year or so later, around the 10-year anniversary of my dad's death, when I was just being really introspective, looking at my life, looking at what I was doing, realizing I had given up this $200,000 a year job 10 years ago to get healthy. Talk about the most expensive diet failure. I mean, what is that? Yeah. $2 million I didn't lose a pound?
Yeah.
I mean, it's just crazy. And I had to do some really deep thinking and figure out, why am I abusing my body? Why am I still eating all the junk that my dad ate? Why am I still eating processed food and M&Ms by the handful and Diet Coke by the liter and French fries every single day?
So addicting. Wow. Those things.
Why
are so
am
addicting.
I still doing that?
And you only and all of that only added 30 something pounds to you?
Because I worked out all the time. I kept trying to outrun my mouth, which never works in any regard, whether
you
it's weight or what I'm saying.
Out exercise
a bad diet.
Yeah, a bad diet.
I love that.
You can't.
You can't. You can't. So
I've been telling clients that for years.
I finally had the light bulb moment. And this is what all my clients who are successful at weight loss and keeping it off, they have the light bulb moment. They find their why. And mine was, I realized that I was still trying to connect to my dad through the thing that we always did together. Mm-hmm. Root beer floats, French fries, peanut M&Ms. That was our language of love.
Yes.
So it was so much comfort eating. And if you had asked me back then if I was an emotional eater, I'd be like, oh, no, I'm not.
It comes in so many different forms.
We all are.
Yeah.
So let's talk about the why again, because I know that in your Eat, Train, Win University, the why is like one of the very first things you have your clients find out before anything else.
Absolutely. You know, willpower runs out, and so many women think that they have to do it alone. Mm-hmm. And if they just had more willpower, or if they didn't have kids, or if they had more time. Mm-hmm. But what I always tell them is why power trumps willpower. Mm-hmm. And why power is that deep-seated emotional reason that actually gives you goosebumps or makes you cry or cringe. That's when you can find your why, like I did. That's when you are going to be unstoppable. And it doesn't mean there won't be bumps in the road. I had bumps in the road. But you will get to your goal and you will stay there when you know your why. Mm-hmm.
So how do they get to there? Because is it a different process for everybody, or do you suggest the same thing for everybody? How do they get that deep and figure out their why?
That's a great question. It's the same process, but sometimes it takes more steps than others.
You're right.
I use a method by Toyota Motor Company that they created back in the 40s for business, but it works really well in weight loss. It's called the five whys. Mm-hmm. So I ask my clients, why do they want to lose weight? And whatever that response is, I ask them, why is that important? Mm-hmm. So I want to fit into my skinny jeans. Great. Why is that important? They may come back and say, well, I'll be more confident. Okay. Why is that important?
Right.
And you just keep going. You know, sometimes it takes five, sometimes it takes 205.
Right.
And you keep digging, and when you nail it, you are golden.
Yeah, these are what in my practice we call high mileage questions, the whys, and you have your client figure it out, because they know. We can't start giving them a list of things that might be the why. They know the why. Oh, you just have to ask the questions.
Yeah. Always, everybody has the answers inside them.
Yes.
Yeah, and
nobody can give you the answers.
And their excuses are actually their reasons why. So if they can't lose weight because of their kids, their kids are their why.
Yeah, what a revelation. Yeah. I love that.
Give us a few more of
their excuses or their reasons why.
Yeah, I like that.
Great
this.
Term.
So give us a few more excuses.
It's true for so
many
things.
Oh, a few more excuses. I don't have time because I work so much. Mm-hmm. Great, evaluate your life. Why are you working so much? Mm-hmm. Is it because you're not being efficient? Do you need better time management so that you can fit in the exercise? Do you realize that exercise will actually make you a better employee or a better entrepreneur or whatever? Yeah. You know, what are you doing for mind, body, soul?
Right. Mm-hmm.
And the soul is just so important.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I used to color code my calendars. So I could just, because I'm such a visual person, I'm a painter as well, and I would look, and each thing I had to do had a color. And I would make sure visually I could see that I was in balance, that the mind, body, soul was all in balance. Like I exercised every day. I took some part of the day to sort of focus on my soul. And I just would, it would just bring peace to me when I'd see that it's all evenly balanced.
It's great to be visual. I have something called the circle of life. that my clients fill out pretty early on within us working together. And, you know, it's putting the dots on the wheel of every single thing, like you color-coded. And then you connect the dots, and you see the things that are low on the wheel, things that are high, things that are more in the balance zone, and then you know where you need to work to get everything to come.
I'm laughing
balance.
Because I use,
you
know, the Wheel
this?
Of Life
Do
also.
Do you use that too?
And mine looked, yes, like Fred Flintstone had chiseled it, and it was not round at all.
Yeah, I have people that are zigzag. One of my clients the other day, we drew, it was a butterfly when we connected the dots. So she like went, voot, voot, you know, and we went, okay, this is a visual of what you need to work on, because those things need to be in balance to have the complete cathartic moment that this is what's going on and this is how I can turn it all around. And then lifestyle change happens. Yeah. It's not diets,
right?
Because those aren't sustainable.
Diets don't work.
And that's the problem, is people, like many of your clients, probably come to you thinking, oh, well, I want to go on a diet. Mm. And then you have to turn that thinking, which is what is so fabulous about what you do.
But for you to lose that 31, to be precise, pounds, now you mentioned that you were a spokesperson for a big national weight loss company.
I was.
So did you follow a specific diet to lose that weight and then move into your own training? How did that work?
Yeah, this is really funny for me to say, but it just goes to show how it is a constant journey of evolution. Mm-hmm. I started my weight loss journey with packaged food that got mailed to me that didn't need to be refrigerated.
Oh, dear. Yeah.
And I'm now like...
And it was it processed?
Oh, it was so... Oh, it was so processed every way but Sunday.
Yeah, figured.
And now I'm all about clean eating, yes, and no processed, mm-hmm, foods or marginally processed, where, mm-hmm, you can see all the ingredients in there. They're all good ingredients. Just
that
somebody,
you recognize the names of.
Somebody put it in a jar for you. So like crunchy peanut butter, ingredients, peanuts. Okay.
That's all you want.
It is processed, exactly. But, you know, that's okay.
They took peanuts and they cleaned it.
Somebody actually processed it for us. So I call that minimally or marginally processed,
yes,
foods, and that's okay. But I tell my clients, if there's an ingredient that will kick you out of a spelling bee, the exception is quinoa. Sometimes that's hard to spell the first time. But if there's an ingredient in something that will kick you out of a spelling bee, that's a very good indication that your body doesn't know what to do with it, and it shouldn't be a part of your regular diet.
That's right.
So funny.
You
can't pronounce it, you shouldn't eat it.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It usually is my rule of thumb.
So you lost the weight through a means that you don't recommend for other people right now. So then once you lost the weight, and how did you come about the Eat, Train, Win University? I want to know how that came.
So as I was doing my own weight loss journey, I started, because of this company that I was using, they had community boards. And I was having success from day one. So then I started coaching everyone on those boards, just as a regular member, offering, mm-hmm, support. And I just remember how great it felt to help people when they were struggling. And you said, you know, I don't recommend this now. This is the funny thing. I have several clients that do get this box of unrefrigerated food. And I'm like, if that is your stepping stone and that's where you want to start, great. Because sometimes it's just too overwhelming to go from junk food diet to clean eating. Mm-hmm. So if that is the start, if that will help them start releasing the weight, getting in the place where they know what proper portion sizes are, I actually high five them. Mm-hmm. And as soon as they're ready, we take those training wheels off and we go to clean eating.
Yeah, good. I can see that sometimes it's a little overwhelming for people. They don't understand the calorie content of I mean, if you stick to fruit and vegetables, I mean, vegetables majority and some fruit and lean meats and protein. I mean, you really can't go wrong, but I know a lot of people don't want to do without their grains and breads and things like that. Mm-hmm. And if you haven't been sort of taking care of yourself and you're not aware of the calorie content, you can get into trouble.
Yeah.
So and it's bigger than calories. It's more about content. Like you said, because I try not to, I don't know if you do this with within your realm of your clients, but I try to stay away from numbers on the scale, numbers of calories. And yes, we have to be aware there are dense calories and there are empty calories compared. But if they start getting too, we want them to have something sustainable for them that is a lifestyle to create. So we do something, I do something with my clients called crowding out. So it's a really, you know what that is, mm-hmm. yeah, just really
what
gradual.
Is crowding out?
So crowding out is gradually adding in the good and crowding out the bad. So it's not so abrupt.
Yeah.
I have a client that started with Weight Watchers, and I like Weight Watchers, mm-hmm. but it's about the numbers and the counting and stuff like that. And the numbers really do, the point system relates to calories. What I've seen with Weight Watchers is it's successful but not 100% sustainable to a healthy lifestyle. It's just about those points. So if you can get people to understand the properties of the food that they're eating and the health content of it, then you're on your road, but it takes time, and that's, you know, and what I love about and what we got to get into is what you do with your clients, okay. and the maintenance,
yes.
and all the programs you have. I just feel, oh, it's so wonderful. I just applaud
well,
you around.
That's
Thank
our
you.
Music. We are going to go to a 2-minute break.
This is
so
our
we're
music.
Very exciting okay. show here with Christy Miller, and she's going to come back in a couple of minutes and share some of her wonderful tools. I know one of them are the 7 keys to creating a winning weight loss mindset. And you've got some
mindset.
Other really great things to share. I know you've got some other summits coming up and workshops, and we're going to share everything. So
excellent.
Thank
how
you.
People can get a hold
stay,
of you too.
Yeah, so stay with us.
Yes.
We will be back. Thank you so much. In 2 minutes.
Right back.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and hosts of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Hi, I'm Del A.D. Jones, and I'm a certified relationship and divorce coach.
And I'm Debbie Carlin Boyle, a certified personal trainer, fitness instructor, and health coach.
Join us on Tuesdays, 2 p.m. Pacific, for Del and Debbie's Mind, Body, Soul, and everything in between, exclusively on LA Talk Live.
Become part of the conversation with expert guests discussing life-changing topics such as relationships, divorce, longevity, parenting challenges, dating, intimacy, and so much more.
We would love to hear your opinions and questions, either on our Facebook page or by calling us directly at 323-473-3100. We are Del and Debbie's Mind, Body, Soul, and everything in between. Tuesdays, 2 p.m. Pacific on latalklive.com.
You can also catch us on iTunes Radio, R&B, and now live on Facebook. Or watch and listen directly at latalklive.com. And now on our YouTube channel, Del and Debbie Mind, Body, Soul. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hi, this is Elena inviting you to join me every Wednesday at noon for Elena's Beauty Talk and more, exclusively on LA Talk Live. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio, R&B, or watch us on Ustream.tv. Reality radio, handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Great. Hi, welcome back. We are Del and Debbie's Mind, Body, Soul on LA Talk Live, and we have the fabulous Christy Miller here. And we were just chatting during our very quick break about calories. We finished off, Debbie was talking about how she is with her clients, and we were going to talk to Christy about some people love counting calories, you mentioned.
Yes, I mean, they actually do. I have one client that's still 4 or 5 years into maintenance. She tracks every bite, lick,
wow.
drop. And that gives her great comfort. So when I start with my clients, they need to be calorie aware.
Mm-hmm.
Now, obviously, the quality is the most important part. But I have clients that say that they are eating high quality foods or just eating too many of them.
Yeah.
So one of the things that we do in the beginning is just help them get calorie aware. And if that means tracking for 3 days, so that they can see in their mind, oh, I'm eating 4,500 calories and my body really wants 2,000 or whatever it is.
Yeah.
I get them so that they can become aware of it, but I don't want anyone to become neurotic and be tied to the point where they can't make a decision and they're crippled if they can't track.
Right.
Because eventually we all want to become intuitive eaters. Mm-hmm. And that's where I am now. In the beginning, I tracked every calorie, good, bad, ugly, because it was giving me information. And what was great about that for me is I got to a point, I think it was about 15 pounds in, where my weight loss stopped. Yeah. I mean, hit a major plateau.
Yeah.
And because I had been tracking, I was able to analyze the numbers, going back to my financial analyst brain.
There you go.
Analyze the numbers and realize that that worked for the first however many weeks. Mm-hmm. But now I needed more calories, not less.
Interesting.
Yeah, because I was doing a P90X, mm-hmm. so intense workouts. And you can get to the point mm-hmm. where if your deficit is too big, your body fights you and it stops losing weight.
Yeah, because it thinks that you're going to keep going, and it does, and you're not going to have anything to protect you.
Yeah.
So it tries to keep a layer around mm-hmm. so you will be sustainable and help.
Right, so I ended up, and as scary as this is, I immediately started adding 500 more calories a day. So scary in weight loss.
Yes.
Within 4 days, the scale started moving again. My body was like, thank you, lady. You have to feed us.
That's so interesting. Now, just as we're on the subject of adding more calories, was it just like at a certain time? Was it once you'd done exercising? Or was it just adding it to your day somehow, somewhere?
I just spread it to the day. Mm-hmm. Now, when we are being, you know, professional athletes, or we're really pushing to get to the echelon of fitness and health, then it's important to play around with the macros and the timing and all of that. But I think for mainstream America, when we're trying to lose weight and we don't have that superpower athletic goal, just spreading it out throughout the day, just eating a balance of carbs, proteins, and fats is going to get you to your goal or pretty close.
Mm-hmm.
And people make it too complicated.
Mm-hmm.
And they get paralysis by analysis. Mm-hmm. And they can't take a step because they're looking for the best diet.
Yep.
Yeah. When the best diet, I always say, the fastest, healthiest, and most sustainable way to lose weight is with clean eating.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's exactly what I say, too. It's exactly what I say.
Very, very clean, too. And lately, I've eliminated a couple of things in honor of my sister. I mean, she has pancreatic cancer, unfortunately. And
sorry.
We've all decided to not drink any wine while she's going through her struggle, and it's been really great. And
how do you feel? That's what I was going to ask you. Because it's been
wonderful.
A while now. It's been like 6-7 weeks,
yes,
right?
Yes, but it's been about 8 weeks. I feel wonderful.
And you've lost weight.
I've lost some weight. Thank you very much.
And
yes.
Tell me how you feel compared to how you were feeling before.
I just feel so good. I mean, I've still got quite a few to go. But again, let me just bring in the scale at this point, because I know people say, oh, don't ever get on the scale. But, you know, for me, the scale works for me. It holds me accountable. Because,
me too.
You know, I know so many people that go, no, I just rely on my clothes to tell me. Well, you know, clothes are stretchy right now. We're not wearing the sort of 50s type tailored clothing where if you did gain a few pounds, you really felt it. You know, clothes grow with you. So I found that once I got the scale back in, and it just really helped. It helped, and it's, you know, some days it doesn't move, or some weeks it doesn't move, but eventually it will. But I just stick with it, and I feel wonderful.
Good.
If somebody opens a really great bottle of wine in front of me, I'm allowed to have a little taste, and I go, okay, tastes great.
Yeah,
I'm not going to drink it.
Yeah, and then the beauty of that is, you know, someday you probably will go back
having,
but you're going to be more moderate about
Absolutely.
It, and you're going to be more wise about it.
And it's just going to be, one of those things again. It's like, I have a goal, so I'm sticking it till my goal is achieved. Mm-hmm. And then incrementally, I can add a bit here and there. And if it feels like it's going up a bit, just once a week, something like that on a special occasion.
Yeah, and that's important, just having the checks and balances and making these everyday not so healthy habits become a fun occasion thing.
Exactly.
And my husband and I just celebrated his 60th birthday. Tough birthday, because it was the first year without his brother, and it was 60. And we went to this fabulous over-the-water bungalow resort in Playa del Carmen. And we ate too much, and we drank too much, and we had a great time. And we got back. We are now not drinking.
Yeah.
Both
yeah.
of us, you yeah. know, supporting each other, not drinking. Yeah. And it's just, number one, it's a much healthier way to live. That's not to say that a month from now we might have a cocktail or might not. We're going to Cabo with 30 other people.
Oh, my goodness.
And
wow.
We are not drinking on the trip, which is going to be really interesting because most people go to Cabo to be really drunk.
Yeah.
So there's going to be some good laughs, a little bit of frustration, I'm sure. But what I always tell my female clients, and I didn't know this until I got certified in nutrition, that first glass of alcohol that you have, it shuts down your metabolism for 6 to 8 hours.
Wow.
So it is not the 100 calories if you're pouring a single serving. Your liver looks at alcohol as poison.
Mm-hmm.
So for 6 to 8 hours, it can't burn fat because it is trying to get the poison out of your body.
Yeah.
So that's fascinating.
Yeah. So that it's glass of wine. Average of 4 hours that takes to
that
get.
That glass of wine
days.
Can cost you 1,000 calories.
Okay, because I was only drinking like a glass of wine, two maybe, but it was one of those rewards. It was at the end of the night. It was like, you know, I want to pour myself a lovely glass of wine. And it just became habitual. And that's another thing I think often is, I'm fascinated by this, that the habit and the neuropathways that are, you know, the reward sort of system that goes into place and that we it plays so much into diet is that we have
that
these
sugary foods and glasses of wine. Oh, God, exactly. I ended the day, you know, TGI Friday. Let's go celebrate the end of the week.
Yeah.
Everybody, let's get drunk. You know, I know my daughter who, you know, my daughters who
are in there, done that,
are in their late 20s and early 30s. It's the first thing them and their friends do, you know, and same, you know, you really can't tell your kids, oh, you can't go, you know, take it
well,
easy.
Well, that information you just shared is unbelievable. I had no idea. I was just counting the glass of wine as like 125 calories, 150 something, if it's a big glass of red wine. But the fact that it shuts down your metabolism, that is
But
really
I do want to say something about that, just because I don't want to make drinking the evil, mean thing.
Right.
And so if we were to look at the blue zones in our world, and there are five blue zones that stand out in the research that was done. Every single one of them has alcohol in it, but in very, very, very moderation. Now, mind you, this is a group of people that are living that what we talked about, all those lines, you know, in the circle of life are balanced.
Mm-hmm.
And they have their spirituality, they have their finances, they have their relationships, they're moving, they're exercising, they're eating well, for the most part, a Mediterranean-type diet, which is all healthy, whole, fresh foods. Unprocessed, but they all have something in common as well. And they all have, the women, on average, it's a drink and a half, and mostly wine, red wine. And the men are up to two drinks. And they're still living well into their 90s, almost into their hundreds. So just, you know, I tell my clients who feel like, oh, I have to give up so much, including the alcohol. You know, initially, yes, you do. But it doesn't mean that you can't come back in. Once you get to the weight that you want to be and you're sustaining, then you can, you know. But as long as you don't have a problem with addiction, I really think that it's an okay thing.
I don't know. I think that also
it's individual.
It's individual. Mm-hmm. And I know for me, because my eating has always been very, very clean, that it just was adding unnecessary calories.
Yes,
and it was the only way I was able to sort of start inching down was by putting that to the side, because everything else pretty much stayed the same. But talking about, I want to get back to these seven keys to creating winning weight loss mindset, because I know one of them, I think it's, where is it here? Number six is about rewards. So we want to talk about healthier rewards rather than the glass of wine at the end of the day.
Yes.
But let's go through this list so that our listeners here can understand how they can achieve that positive mindset.
So really quickly, the seven keys to creating the winning weight loss mindset are: identify your five whys. So we talked about that earlier. Visualize the new you. Astronauts use it.
Yeah.
Jim Carrey uses it. I can't imagine what he's visualizing. That's probably pretty crazy in his head.
Oh, we have a caller. Oh, we're going to interrupt you for just 1 second so we don't lose them.
Yes.
Hi, caller. Are you there?
Hi, I am here.
Hi. What's your name and where are you calling from?
This is Jane. I'm calling from New York. And I just have a question. I lost 88 pounds and I've been maintaining it for over a year now.
Wow.
And, you know, I think like the first year was kind of like, okay, I can do this. And once I get to like a year in maintenance, I should be able to do this with no problem. And it's, you know, I still struggle from time to time. And when does this get easier? I don't know if you have an answer to this question, but.
When does it get easier? Yes. First of all, Jane, congratulations. Jane is one of my superstars.
Oh, wow. And congratulations,
Jane. Do you have anything you want to say about that Wheel of Life?
I hate the Wheel of Life.
That's what I thought you were going to say.
It's hard to stay in balance, isn't it, Jane? It's tricky.
So how does it get easier? You know, as we improve our emotional fitness, and that's that number of how well are we doing with not feeding our emotions, you know, not feeding it with food. Every year we get stronger. And as we create more and more healthy habits, those are crowding out the unhealthy habits. Mm-hmm. So Jane, I know personally that you are doing so well, and each year it will get better and better. And it is a journey. Like my husband and I just cut out alcohol and I'm eating less animal products. Now, if you had asked me 3 years ago when I was already 3 years into maintenance if I would ever consider either of those, I would have said no. But it just becomes our new normal. And the longer you do it, Jane, you will notice that it gets easier and easier as you keep improving your emotional fitness. Does that make sense?
Yeah. And I think that's what's hard this year, because there's a lot of things going on emotionally from this year where they weren't last year. So it's like it's still my go-to cure.
So it's you know, the journaling, the reaching out, getting the support, the accountability, doing everything that you're doing, just keep doing it, and it will get easier.
Yeah, it's obviously work. That's a huge achievement. I mean, congratulations. That must feel wonderful.
Yeah, I mean, life gives us those ups and downs, and you have. Yeah. It seems that you've gotten Christy's given you some great tools to really get through
Christy's
the downs.
Christy's amazing.
You know, yes,
Except the wheel, she said.
Yeah, that's accountability, and that's what Christy's all about now for you, is accountability. We all need that in our lives. So, well, good luck with everything.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thanks, Jane.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
All right, thanks. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you. So, let's get back to these seven keys.
So, identify the five whys, visualize a new you, set the bar low, and I mean
that's
really low.
Yeah.
If the horse hasn't run around the track in 4 years, it's not going to win the Kentucky Derby tomorrow. Too often dieters, because they get that dieter mentality of I have to give up everything, and then they can't maintain. It's too hard. It's all or nothing. It's perfectionism. Mm-hmm. That never works. I get my clients to start small, little baby steps that are practical, achievable, and sustainable. Yeah. So, for instance, start with a healthy breakfast. Mm-hmm. You want to eat an unhealthy lunch? You want to eat an unhealthy dinner? Great. Go ahead. Let's get the breakfast healthy first. Then we'll start moving into the other meals.
Let me ask you, just really quick, an aside, what is a healthy breakfast? What would you recommend to a client to start with?
You know, it's different for everyone. Mm-hmm. It could be something as simple as peanut butter toast, but with good, healthy bread, and there is such a thing. Mm-hmm. It could be egg whites with vegetables. It could be overnight oatmeal. It really depends.
So you give them what resonates with them, what will spark them that they'll like.
What are you eating now? How do we healthify
it? We have another caller.
Oh, wow.
Great.
Caller, are you there?
What's your name? Hello, yes, I'm here.
Hi.
What's your name?
I was wondering.
What's your name and where are you calling from?
Oh, my name is Debbie, and I'm calling from Los Angeles.
Hi, Debbie. How are you?
Hi, I'm doing well, thank you.
Good.
I am just starting on my weight loss journey, and I look out there, and there's so much contradictory information that I get all geared up for it.
So confusing.
And then it just seems like I'm confused. How do I know where to start? What's the most important thing I can do?
Yeah, I would say close all those books, close all the magazines, get off the internet, and really just go back to clean eating. How can you create a breakfast that is all whole foods? How can you create a lunch that's all whole foods? How can you create a dinner? So, I mean, we were just talking about setting the bar low, really low, and the all or nothing and perfectionist attitude.
And the crowding out.
And the crowding out. So, look at your plate. Have half of your plate be fruits and vegetables, which is so ironically hard for me to say because I used to be the card-carrying vegetable hater. And now there are vegetables that I can actually say I love and crave.
Yeah. Me too.
Never would have imagined that 10 years ago.
Absolutely.
So, Debbie, just take baby steps. Like, start with your breakfast. And when you've got that down and it's healthy, then you can move on to your lunch. And in terms of exercise, exercise, if you're not exercising now, start with 15 minutes of walking every day. You know, maybe four days a week. And then when you get 4 days a week, increase it in time or intensity or in number of days a week. But just think of it like building a house. You have to pour the foundation before you can put up the walls, the next floor, and the roof.
Absolutely. Yeah. Or like any skill set or anything, even taking a salsa dance class, you're not going to be, you know, ballroom ready after the fourth lesson. It's one step literally at a time. And that's how diet and exercise work. And, just start crowding out the bad stuff, putting in the good stuff, one little baby step at a time. You're going to start to crave the good stuff.
Yeah.
Watch.
And moving on to number four on Christy's list here, love yourself. And really just, I think that's such an important thing, is to really love yourself through this process and to just...
good self-care.
Yeah.
Good self-care, self-compassion.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Forgiving yourself for the point in your life where you got. Mm-hmm. You know, I had to forgive myself for those 10 years of eating junk food when I said that I was quitting my job to focus on my health and happiness. Starts with a place of forgiveness and then self-love. And every time you hear your inner critic, it's that voice that tells you you're not good enough, you're fat, you're ugly, you'll never lose weight.
Yep.
Yes.
Think about how you should be talking to yourself. If that was a three-year-old kid, how would you talk to that three-year-old version of yourself? And I actually have a picture of me blowing out candles on my birthday. And I think I'm 3 or 4 years old, I keep that on my desk. Mm. So the times when I'm doing something that just seems so hard, like, you know, when you start a radio show, you have no idea how to do it. And you start telling yourself it's too hard. Or when we're starting a diet, I keep that picture of myself as a three-year-old. And I was really cute back then. and I just think I look back to her. So Debbie, constantly talk to your inner child and tell her that it's going to be okay. And tell her it's okay to be scared of this new journey that you're on that's so exciting and scary at the same time. But you got this, and reach out for help if you need anything. We are all here for you, and nobody has to go it alone.
Mm, beautiful.
Well, I thank you very much. You put it in more manageable steps, and I thank you for your time.
Wow. You're welcome.
Thank you for calling in. We wish you luck. Thank you so much.
Reach out
if you need to talk to us, and talk to us on our Facebook page.
Wonderful.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay,
wow,
I'm keeping us on track here.
I'm so glad we're helping people.
We are going to move on to number five of the seven, which is upgrade your fave five. I found this one really interesting because, you describe it and then I'll share my experience in this.
The late, great Jim Rohn said, you become the average of the five people you hang around with most.
Wow.
It's true in every area of your life. If you are hanging out with fast food junkies, you're the fast food junkie.
Mm-hmm.
So if you aspire to be healthier, if you aspire to be happier, you have to get new friends. And sometimes you have to see your family less.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what it takes. Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean that you're not still going to be friends with the people that are eating junk food and drinking all hours of the night. But if you want to up-level yourself and you want to upgrade and reach your new goals, you have to start flying with a different flock to get there.
Or the other thing is that you can do things together, because I noticed when I went home, I'm obviously from Britain, and when I went home in February, I'd been home in December. I go home a lot now because of the illness in my family. Between Christmas and when I went in the first week of February, as I mentioned, a few of my siblings had decided they weren't going to drink, and they'd lost all this weight. And I was like, wait a minute, I didn't get the memo. Thank you so much. But there was something about us doing it as a group and deciding as a group to be supportive, to be healthy, and to honor my sister and her struggle by really watching what we were consuming, whether it was alcohol or how we were eating. And it just became so much easier when we did it as a group.
It does. And you also knew your why.
Yeah.
Your why was for your sister and supporting
and
each other.
And for ourselves.
And for ourselves, too.
Yeah.
And it's so important.
It
you
just
knew
felt
your why
disrespectful and you had to abuse our bodies when she was struggling so much. It just felt like I felt that she was suffering for she'd taken a bullet for us, I felt. and that she was the wake-up call, and that we all really needed to pay attention and to honor her. It was really important.
You touched on it before, it within the family, your husband, and changing things, and things changed for him because collectively you both lost a total of over 60 pounds, I think you said. Same thing, within my family, I realized that my lifestyle wasn't going to change unless I gradually helped the rest of the people in my family change their lifestyle. And my husband subsequently lost a lot of weight, became a lot healthier, stopped drinking all the beer. He was like when I met him, he was living on beer, tacos, and hot dogs.
And he had that
big beer belly. And the first time I met his parents, I remember his mom, he had lost like 15, 20 pounds because it took almost a year for me to meet his parents. But when I met them, his mom looked at me and said, "What are you doing to my son?" Almost in a negative way because he looked a little too skinny, tall, thin. And, you know, I had to say, he's on the health track now. You know, he's getting healthy. And really, it was just cutting out the junk food and just starting slowly. But I realized if he was going to be with me, that we had to be very like-minded in our process and the way we eat. And a lot of my clients are in a household that may not be so healthy. So we do a little bit of cupboard looking into, refrigerator looking into. I do a market shop tour with them. I can do it virtually or I can do it with them physically because things have to shift within the household and within the lifestyle of those that you love the most as well, or it's very hard to be sustainable. Very hard.
It is. I want to make sure we're going to get to the end of these, so I'm going to bring it back to you again, Christy. So number 6 on your list of the 7 keys is reward yourself, or as you say, bribe yourself. So can you talk about some healthy rewards that...
I'm all for bribes, whether it's a piece of jewelry, a massage, a bubble bath. What I'm doing at the end of the night now is I'm having a mocktail.
Yeah.
Where I put it in a fancy glass. Mm-hmm. It might be club soda. It might be just sparkling water with a little splash of fresh squeezed orange juice, not the orange juice from the store with all the sugar and preservatives. Right. And put it in a nice glass and just have this unwinding healthy habit.
I do that all the time, too.
Yeah. Some lime.
Yeah. Or even that, for the red wine drinkers, even that that pomegranate juice, the fresh squeezed pomegranate juice, a touch of that full of sparkling water in a wine glass is a great substitute.
And you have that feeling. And you can do that when you go to a bar socially. Sure. You know, happy hours always get to be so big because everybody's ordering the latest, greatest drink on the menu. Yeah. And there you are going, I'm not drinking.
Yeah. And nobody knows it, so they don't get in your business.
No, exactly.
It's so good.
So finally, we're on number 7, ask for support and be accountable. So talk a little bit about that.
You know, we don't have to do this alone. Mm-hmm. And as we mentioned it earlier, as women, we think I should just be able to lose weight alone. I didn't lose my weight alone. I had support. I had accountability. And it's so important because it keeps you focused, because there will be days when you're just like, screw it. Mm. I don't want to do this anymore. But if you have either your coach or your girlfriend, or you're doing it with a spouse, you can help each other. You can keep each other on track and you will get to your goal faster. And you will stay there longer if you have the accountability and support. I think that is one of the biggest pieces to changing permanently.
I totally agree.
I agree. Absolutely. Yeah, because maintenance is so hard. You know, as Jane was saying, calling in, you know, when does it get easier? It's a lifestyle change that just challenges us every day. But life is challenging, and it's, you know, how we handle it that keeps us, you know, as healthy as we can possibly be. And we got to keep our food and our fitness in track, because those are the two things on the top tier. If everything else starts falling into place, clarity, you know, and just seeing each day through one day at a time.
It does. And I actually think that maintenance is easier than weight loss. And I teach my clients how to get into that mindset also.
Yes.
It's about setting a new goal, because so often in weight loss, there's applause for you on the scale when that goes away. And when people stop telling you how great you look, even though you still look great.
Yeah, you feel like you can get away with stuff.
You have to be able to reward yourself in different ways so that maintenance is fun and enjoyable.
And give yourself time. It's like if they say it takes 40 days to create new habits, you know, so you just have to give yourself time to work
into
it.
And even, I mean, and I could do a whole show about habits. I'm very into
should.
The habits.
We should.
Exactly.
Really.
So, but I, we're really getting close here. Oh my goodness! I want you to share your website, and I know that you have a program coming up called Feel Good for Life. I want you to just talk about that very quickly, and how our listeners can get in touch with you. Would
and
be
fabulous. All the things you offer. If
okay.
They do get in
so,
touch with
so
you.
Feel Good for Life is starting on June 5th. It is an 8-week road trip to a healthier you.
Oh, I love that road trip.
Very small group program, limited to 20 new riders.
Wow.
And then our alumni come back in and participate and support the new riders also. It's fabulous. I'm in the group. I'm coaching for an hour each week live. And so there's a lot of accountability, a lot of support, and a
wow.
whole lot of fun.
Yeah.
And it's, sorry, guys, it's ladies only. No boys allowed.
Yeah, but next time, we'll
yeah,
do boys.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. To find me, just go to eattrainwin.com. And you can look at my services, and there'll be a button you can go find out more about Feel Good for Life.
Wonderful. And I noticed you had 3 points, too, on your little notes there.
Yeah.
I saw 3 points. Share those very quickly.
3 reasons why you should use the F word. Food, fitness, and fun.
Yes.
Yeah, that's
yes.
Do those
good
three things and you are good.
Effort.
Say it again. Food,
fitness
and
fun.
Absolutely.
It all goes hand in hand.
Yeah.
Well, this has been fabulous.
I
just
know.
Want to thank you for your knowledge and your inspiration and encouragement.
Yeah.
Wow. Thank you so much.
We could have
much.
Gone on for another 3 hours.
I know.
It just went
we'll
so
do it
fast.
Again. We'll do it
yeah,
again.
Well, maybe another time
yes.
we can
yes.
have you back. But thank you. Thank you for sharing
thank
your inspiration.
You. Thank you.
And being such a wonderful role model for people.
Thank
so,
you.
Yeah, thank you.
We thank you, too. This is Del Debbie's Mind, Body, and Soul. We'll be right back here at 2 p.m. next week. Thanks, everybody. Get a hold of Christy.
Thank
Get
you.
A hold of us if you need us at our on our Facebook pages. Talk to you soon.
See
ya. Bye.
Lovely. Thank you. Have a wonderful week. Bye-bye.
Thank you for tuning into LA Talk Live and the Talk Live Broadcast Network, original reality radio, handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk. Stay tuned.